Of course, there are many textbooks, and I can show. This is one textbook. I could see it, I don't know. Because of background, it is not showing up. So, it is Fundamentals of Metal Cutting and Machine Tools. Fundamentals of Metal Cutting and Machine Tools by B.L. Juneja. And there are two more others. Sekhana and Seth. So this is one good book, and of course there are many other books. So this book mainly, okay, I'll use this for maybe some 70% content, okay, about that. And of course there are many other books and the NPTEL course on manufacturing process, so that it will also be very much used. And there is a book by Chattopadhyay, Machine Tools book. I think I'll just look at the title. Exact title is this: Machining and Machine Tools by A.B. Chattopadhyay. So almost the content for NPTEL was taken from that book only. Okay, so teacher was same, A.B. Chattopadhyay. And Metal Cutting Principles by M.C. Shah. Okay, this is one good book by Oxford University. And okay, there are some books for unconventional machining process or non-traditional machining process by Modern Machining Process by V.K. Jain. That is one book. And non-traditional or unconventional machining process by Mishra. That is one book. And P.C. Pandey, that is also one book for non-conventional or unconventional machining process. So these are some of the textbooks. And of course there is a textbook by Boothroyd that is very well known and a reputed textbook, that is Metal Cutting. Metal Cutting is the broad title, and it is by Boothroyd. Okay, that list maybe I'll include in the lecture schedule. I'll share that lecture schedule maybe tomorrow, I guess. So these are the different textbooks you can refer for studying this subject. Okay, don't rely completely on PPTs. So PPTs are only for guidelines. Okay, they will give you the subheadings and side headings. Okay, for main content, complete content, you have to refer at least two, three textbooks. Okay, now let us start today's topic. So the first topic in this machining science is about tool geometry. And of course, before that, we have seen the introduction. So tool geometry. So in your last course, that is machine tools and metrology subject, you have studied the various elements of machine tools. Okay. You have taken one lathe, you have studied various components of that lathe. Okay. What is headstock, what is tailstock, what is chuck, okay, what is the tool post, etc. What is the function of feed rod and okay, lead screw. So all those things you have studied. You have calculated the machining times, okay, on various machines, including lathe, milling machine, okay, mecha. So, and shaper mechanism and quick return mechanism, all those things you have studied. So your study was mainly focused on these machine tools and how they function, how the relative motion between the cutting tool and the workpiece is achieved. So that is achieved with the help of a machine tool. So you have studied the components of machine tool. Now in this course, our focus will be mainly on the cutting tool and the workpiece. So what are the requirements of the cutting tool? Okay, for cutting a particular geometry, Okay, what are the features that the machine tool should have? So those things we will study. What should be the material of the cutting tool? So during cutting, so there will be, okay, you may be using some cutting fluid. We'll study what are the types of cutting fluids we have to use for various applications. And we'll also study the temp, okay, about the temperature that is being generated during machining process. And how to estimate the tool life. Every component will have some life. So how do you estimate the tool life? What are the different types of tool wears? So all these aspects we'll study in this subject. And once we complete our discussion on conventional machining, we'll discuss the few unconventional machining process. We'll see the classification of unconventional machining process, and we'll discuss few of them in detail. So those are the different topics that will be covered in this subject. And of course, the first topic is tool geometry. Now, why do we need to study the tool geometry? Or what is the significance of tool geometry? Okay, suppose you want to cut one raw material into some shape. Now, for cutting that required shape, the tool should have a particular shape. Okay, you cannot use any tool and cut any geometry. It is not possible. And if you have this tool in a particular manner, then your cutting process will be easy. Okay, you with less power consumption, you can easily cut the required geometry. So that is one thing. And you will get the required surface finish also. Okay, if the tool geometry is not correct, you will not get the good surface finish. So you'll get good surface finish. That depends, okay, on the tool geometry and power consumption also. Okay, it is dependent on the tool geometry to some extent. And if you are using a tool in a particular shape, its life will also be more. Okay, so like that, this tool geometry impacts the effectiveness and the efficiency of the metal cutting process. So if you have good tool, the process will be effective and it will be more efficient. Efficient means less power consumption. With less power consumption, you can cut the desired geometries. So hence, okay, having a tool of correct geometry is very, very important. And we should know how the tool is designated according to different standards. And what are the different angles that are present on the cutting tool, and what is their significance, and how they will affect the machining process. So for that, we have to understand the geometry of the cutting tool. Now, if you take any cutting tool, you have already used cutting tools in your laboratory, machining and metrology laboratory. So you might have observed, okay, that cutting tool, okay, of course it has a sharp corner, but that sharp corner is formed by some planes. Okay, there are two, three planes are there. So with the intersection of those planes, we are getting some lines, and intersection of lines are leading to the formation of that tool tip. Okay, so using that tool tip, you are cutting the material, you are removing the material in the form of chips. So if you observe the cutting tool, okay, there are two very, very important angles that are present. We'll look at them. But before we talk about that, those two angles. So in the ancient days, or in the very old, if you go back to some 500 years back, okay, around that, or in the very old ancient days also, so people use it to remove the material. Okay, so suppose from some tree trunk, they used to remove some material using some stone. Okay, so that stone would not have a particular definite geometry. They used to hold that stone in their hands and they used to remove the material. So they used to use the stones for hunting different animals, etc. But there was no particular shape. Okay. So if you do not have a particular shape for the cutting tool, you may be able to remove the material, but not effectively and efficiently. Okay, you have to exert a heavy force and material removal rate will be less. Okay, very less amount of material will be removed even after using so much of energy. So that used to be the case in the earlier days. So you can see in this figure A. So earlier cutting used to be of this form. Okay, some blunt tool or the stone, okay, is being used to remove the material here in this figure. Now later on, humans have developed some kind of tools. Earlier form of this cutting tool was like chisel. Okay, so there used to be one chisel shaped tool, so that is used to remove the material. So you can see, you can use some force here. So it was inserted into some kind of wood, or any other material, and there will be some impact force coming onto that chisel, and that used to remove the material. So whenever you are talking about chisel, so you have now some angles here. So this angle alpha is called rake angle in this figure, and this angle here between this face of the chisel and the machined surface is called the clearance angle. Alpha is rake angle, here theta is clearance angle. So here zeta is also there, one angle. This is the angle at which the chisel is inserted into this work material. Okay, these two angles are very, very important. You should have some rake angle and a clearance angle. Clearance angle is very, very important. If clearance angle is not there, you see here, there is no clearance angle almost. So your cutting action will not take place at a single point. Okay, you are removing the material, entire plane is in contact with the workpiece material. So there will be a lot of friction and rubbing action is taking place, and generally cutting action will be very less. So, but if you have very sharp edge, how do you create sharp edge? If you provide rake angle and some clearance angle, you can get that sharp edge. Then you can easily remove the material. And of course, we will study more details in the coming slides. So now you can see here, imagine this is a chisel only. Okay, it is looking like a pencil here. Okay, just for a representation purpose, it is given like that. So here you see, this is the machined surface and the face of the cutting tool. Okay, here this face is called flank surface. Okay, now here face of the cutting tool on this side, this surface is called rake surface of the cutting tool. So this is rake surface, this is flank surface. Now the cutting tool is moving in this direction. Okay, you are exerting some force and moving the cutting tool in this direction. So this direction is represented. Okay, so this direction is representing the cutting velocity direction. Okay, or simply cutting direction. Then you have this reference plane. There is a plane called reference plane, which is represented by pi r. This pi r is always perpendicular to the cutting velocity. Okay. So cutting velocity vector is normal to the reference plane always. So that is one thing you have to observe. And the angle between this flank surface and the machined surface is called clearance angle. So it may be denoted with alpha here. Okay, the notation varies from textbook to textbook. So you have to carefully observe how we are denoting this clearance angle. So just in the previous slide you have seen, alpha was given for rake angle. Now we are talking about alpha is given to the clearance angle. Don't confuse with the symbols. You remember the name, clearance angle. Now angle between the rake surface and pi r, that is reference plane, is the rake angle. So here it is represented by gamma. Now is it clear? Do you have any doubt up to this point?
No, sir.
So now you see, we are looking at this side view of a turning process here. You can call it as a side view. Depends on from which angle you are viewing. Now this is the shaft. This circle. This is one circle. This is outside. So this is the complete, from this point to this point is the outer diameter of that shaft, or the diameter of the given raw material shaft. So you are removing one layer from that shaft. Outside layer of some thickness, radial thickness is there. So you are removing one layer, using that turning process on lathe machine. So if you observe now, what is the cutting velocity direction? This is rotating in this direction. So this is the tool tip. So at this point, cutting velocity is in this direction. Cutting velocity means the tool is moving in this direction. In fact, tool is not moving, workpiece is moving in the downward direction. So naturally the tool, is moving in the opposite direction. Even though it is stationary, cutting action is in the opposite direction. That's why. So this is the velocity vector VC. This is the direction of the velocity vector. Now a plane perpendicular to that, at the starting point of the cutting velocity vector, that is pi r. So that is represented by this pi r symbol. Now as I told you, angle between the rake surface, now this is rake face, this line, and the reference plane is represented with gamma, that is rake angle. Now angle, this surface is the flank surface of the cutting tool. Angle between the flank surface and the machined surface, this is the machined surface, but if you take at this point, you take a tangent. So this is the angle between the flank surface and the machined surface, that is represented with alpha. So this is how you represent rake angle and clearance angle in a turning process. Now the rake angle can be positive, it can be zero, and it can be negative also. Whereas clearance angle should be either zero or positive. It cannot be negative. So why, we will see. Now let us talk about the positive rake angle. Or we'll just see the representation of positive rake angle. So when do you use positive rake angle? We'll see in the coming slides. So positive rake angle is like this. Okay. So angle between the rake surface and the reference plane is the rake angle. So if it is down, okay, if it is in the downward direction, then this angle is called positive rake angle. Okay, clearance is positive clearance if the angle is in this direction. Now let us see what is a negative rake. Negative rake means, now you see here, this is the point of cutting. So this is the pi r plane, and if the tool, okay, tool surface, rake surface is going above the reference plane, okay, when you are looking from this point, so then you can call it as a negative rake, negative rake angle. And zero rake angle means pi r, okay, pi r is coinciding with the rake surface, so then that is zero rake angle. All other things are constant in these three figures. So if it is going below the pi r plane, that is positive. If it is going above the pi r plane, then it is negative. Then if rake surface is coinciding with pi r plane, then that is zero. And in all these figures, the clearance angle is shown as positive. It should be always positive. Okay, even zero also will create problem during machining. Why it should be positive always means, suppose if it is negative, it will be something like this. Okay, it is going in into the machined surface. So if the tool is going into the machined surface, there will be rubbing action, and it will be jammed. Cutting tool will be jammed into the workpiece, and there will not be any cutting taking place. Proper cutting will not take place. Okay, machine surface will be damaged, and in fact proper machining will not take place because the tip is here and you have a plane, okay, in front of it. So there won't be any proper cutting. So clearance angle should be always positive or at least zero, okay, at the max. Zero will also create problem because, okay, zero means just they will be rubbing against each other, this plane, okay, flank surface and the machine surface. So all of you should have positive clearance angle. Now let us see what is this positive rake, negative rake and zero rake angles. That means when we will choose tools having positive rake angle, when will you choose tools having negative rake and zero rake? Now here we can see a tool with a positive rake angle. So this is the angle here, positive rake angle. So we'll choose positive rake angle in some of the cases, like when we are machining low strength ferrous and non-ferrous materials and work hardening materials. So the point you have to understand here is, whenever you are machining low strength materials, okay, so then you can use a positive rake angle. That means whenever you are using positive rake angle, so tool is sharp. Observe, tool is something like this here. Okay, or I'll draw it once more. Tool shape is somewhat like this. Okay, so tool tip is sharp if you are using positive rake. If you are using negative rake, tool is like this. Okay, then tool is okay, strong, understand, but it is not sharp. So if the cutting tip is sharp, that means it cannot withstand high forces because it is thin. So whenever okay, some high amount of force is coming onto this tip, it will break. So when the tip is sharp, we have to use it for low strength materials. Okay, so it can be used for ferrous materials and non-ferrous materials also. So you have to choose the cutting tool material carefully whenever you are using it for different materials. And work hardening materials also. So during machining, the material ahead of the tool tip will be compressed. So that will become now stronger. Okay, its strength will increase. If that is the case, okay, yeah, you can choose the material, positive rake angle. Okay, if material has such kind of character. Now when using low power machines, this is also true. So we are dealing with materials of less strength. So for cutting them, we need only less power is sufficient. So whenever you are using low power machine tools, better you use the positive rake angle so that with less force you can cut the material easily because tool is sharp. That is the only reason. So in case of work hardening materials also, you may wonder why, if the material is becoming stronger, then why you are using this kind of tool? Because work hardening itself will be reduced if you are using sharp cutting tool. Understand? If you are using blunt cutting tool, that means I am talking about this tool with negative rake angle. So material will be compressed ahead. Understand? Ahead of the tool tip, material will be very much compressed because tip is not sharp. Okay, cutting edge is not very sharp here. So material will be compressed. So that means now the material is becoming more strong. So that is not desirable. So if you are using thin cutting tool and sharp cutting tool, this work hardening tendency itself will be decreased. So you can use this positive rake angle easily. Now when machining long shafts of small diameters, so we are machining the long shafts of small diameter. If you are let us say, if you are using negative rake angle for machining small diameter work pieces, what will happen? Negative rake means tool is thick. So now if you are using a thick or blunt tool, so definitely there will be more force coming onto the workpiece. So more force means if it is thin, it will be deflected. So hence you have to use a sharp cutting tool in this case. Now when the setup lacks strength and rigidity, so for tool holding there will be some fixtures, some jigs and fixtures will be used. So if that setup, jigs and fixtures are not very rigid, they are not very strong, so then better you use this positive rake. So if you see all these points, the reason is, so with a sharp cutting tool, with very less power only, you can achieve the desired machining. So that is the reason behind all these scenarios. And when cutting at low speeds, so if you are using sharp cutting tool, so then it can easily remove the material. If you are using blunt cutting tool, that too at lower speeds, very low speeds, then machining will become very, very difficult. Okay, so these are the situations when you will use tool with positive rake angle. Any doubt here? Is it clear when we will use?
Yes.
Positive rectangle. Okay. Now negative rectangle. So you can just observe this figure. So negative rectangle case, it is in this fashion. Tool tip is here. Okay. So you just see the previous case. Tool tip is here. So this is how the cutting tool shape is. Okay. Now this is the case. Now when will we use a negative rectangle? So when machining high strength alloys. So for machining high strength alloys, you need tool which can withstand high forces. So if you want to withstand high forces, if you should have strong tool or thick tool. Okay, if you have very sharp cutting tool like this, let us say in the positive rectangle case, then it will easily break. Okay, it cannot accept high amount of force. So in that case, you have to use negative rectangle. So when there are heavy impact loads such as interrupted machining, suppose if you are machining a cam on a lathe machine, so then there is that interrupted cutting will be there. Or if you are doing some eccentric turning also, some interrupted cutting will be there. Okay, in those cases, so impact forces are coming. So if your impact forces are there, then a tool needs to be definitely strong. So when you need that kind of a strong tool, so go for negative rectangle. Now for rigid setups and when cutting at high speeds, so your setup is very rigid, there is no problem, it can withstand high forces. Okay, and you can choose the tool with negative rake. And when cutting at high speeds, for cutting is less. Okay, force that needs to be accepted by the cutting tool is less. Understand? So you can use this negative rake angle and cutting at higher speeds. But of course, it depends on not only speed. Okay, you have to consider feed and depth of cut. All this combination is required. Okay, only based on speed you cannot choose the cutting tool. Okay, here the meaning is, if you are going for high depth of cut, that is not mentioned in these points, so that is also important. If your depth of cut is high, so you better go for of course, it depends on the type of material also, again, whether we are dealing with ductile material or high strength material. So if you see only speed as a parameter, then at high speeds you can use this cutting tool. Let us not mix all these parameters together, let us see them independently. At high speeds you can use negative rake angles. So it is expected that high force is coming onto the cutting tool. In fact, at high speeds, if the depth of cut is less, so you need very less amount of force from the tool. But a tool coming onto the force coming onto the tool will be high. Okay. If the workpiece is rotating, let us say turning process at very high speed, so definitely high force is coming onto the cutting tool. Understand? So then you have negative rake angle. So is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now let us look at the geometry of cutting tool. So this is how a cutting tool looks like. It is not very perfect figure, but for the sake of explanation, this figure is drawn. So this is the tool tip actually. Okay. So now let us see different features of single point turning tool. So we are talking about the tool that you have used in your workshop for turning purpose. Now let us have a look at the different features. So that highlighted red color line is principal cutting edge. Okay, principal cutting edge. Now this one is auxiliary cutting edge. So you have to remember all these names. So that is tool nose. So intersection of these two cutting edges, primary cutting edge and auxiliary cutting edge, and of course this flank surface, principal flank and auxiliary flank surface. Okay, all the, those are meeting at this tip. Now we have looked at three features. Now that plane whichever is highlighted now is rake surface or rake face. Okay, now this one here is flank surface or principal flank surface. There is another flank surface, that is auxiliary flank surface. So at the bottom of this cutting tool, the plane is called base of the cutting tool. So the portion, okay, which is used to hold the cutting tool in tool post, that portion is called shank. So from this point to the remaining up to the end of this cutting tool, that is called as shank. Okay, now if you look at different features of the single point cutting tool, there is one rake surface. So where is that rake surface? This one, rake face. Principal cutting edge, that is this one. Auxiliary cutting edge is this. Principal flank surface is this. Auxiliary flank surface is this. And tool nose will be present here. Okay, so there will not be very sharp tip. Okay, there will be some radius. Okay, you will provide some curvature here to avoid this breakage of tool tip. So that, okay, we'll see more details later. So these are the features of a single point cutting tool. So all of you must remember all these, okay, because we are going to use these names, okay, very frequently in our course. So I'll say we are talking about some principal flank surface or auxiliary flank surface or rake surface or principal cutting edge, auxiliary cutting edge. So different names we are going to use. So whenever we use that name, you should be able to recall, okay, so what we are talking about which surface we are talking about. So this we have to, okay, remember all these points. And of course, okay, just a second, you can see I am showing different yellow color lines here. Just observe those. And then these are not required at this stage, actually. Okay, so this yellow line is along the principal cutting edge, and this line is along, not this is perpendicular to that. Okay, these are not required at this stage. Okay, we will see them very soon. Okay, you up to this point you have to remember all these features. Okay, so the significance of those yellow lines, why they are shown, okay, will be discussed very soon. Is it clear in this slide what are the different features? Okay, if you have any doubt, you please ask me those doubts now. So this is only the terminology that you have to remember. Now left hand and right hand cutting tools are there. Now what is left hand cutting tool? What is right hand cutting tool? So here you can see in the first for the first cutting tool, this is the principal cutting edge, this is the auxiliary cutting edge. Okay, and if you look at the this one thumb of this left hand, okay, here the worker is holding the cutting tool with left hand, here it is held with right hand. So this is the direction in which you have this principal cutting edge, and the cutting tool will move in this direction during cutting. Okay, so thumb indicates the direction of feed. Thumb indicates the direction of feed motion during cutting. So if the tool is moving away from the chuck in case of turning process, the tool is moving away from the chuck in case of turning process, then that kind of tool is called, okay, left hand cutting tool. And if the principal cutting edge is on this side, and if the cutting tool is moving towards the principal, towards the chuck during cutting, cutting tool is moving towards the chuck during cutting, that kind of tool is called right hand cutting tool. So generally in our workshops or in our laboratories, we are using the right hand cutting tools. Okay, our cutting tool will move towards the chuck. Then why do you need such kind of left hand cutting tools? Any guesses? In which scenario you may have to use a left hand cutting tool? Okay, suppose you are doing some step turning operation and you have to have a larger diameter on the right hand side. Okay, you are holding the workpiece on this, okay, at this location. Here you have chuck. So it is held like that, and you need, okay, 90 here one kind of step. Then your cutting tool needs to move from left to the right. So in that case, you should have left hand cutting tool. Okay, because we should get a 90 degree at this location. Understand? If you are using right hand cutting tool, you will get something like this. You will not get a sharp 90 degree. Okay, I have just exaggerated this. Okay, but you will not get a 90 degree. So in those cases, generally you will use a left hand cutting tool. It is not widely used. Generally, we are going to use right hand cutting tool only. Okay. So for representing cutting tool, there are some standards. So one way of representing the cutting tool is tool in hand system. Just you take the tool in your hand and observe various features of the cutting tool and various angles of the cutting tool. So that is tool in hand system. Here, salient features of the cutting tool point are identified or visualized. Simply, you will look at the cutting tool and you will identify this is the flank surface, this is the rake surface, this is the clearance angle, this is the rake angle, like that. Okay, we have already seen such kind of description in this figure. Whatever you have seen here, okay, is according to tool in hand system only. So that is one way. Now the second is machine reference system, that is also called ASA system, American Standards Association system. Okay, so machine reference system. So based on the machine axis, the geometry of the cutting tool will be defined. So machine will have one longitudinal axis, one transverse axis, one vertical axis. generally if we take xyz directions. So based on those directions, based on the machine axis, if you are defining the tool features, then that is machine reference system. So another type is tool reference system. So under tool reference system, you have different types again. One of them is orthogonal rake system. The other one is normal rake system. Okay, there are few more, but we are not going to discuss those things. So these two are enough for us. Okay. So mainly these are widely used. So you have orthogonal rake system and a normal rake system. We'll see the details of these systems in the coming classes. Let us not bother about what is orthogonal rake system, what is normal rake system at this stage. Okay, we'll anyhow discuss them in detail. Now, work reference system. So here you have to understand is tool reference system means based on some faces or the edges of the cutting tool itself, we are going to define features of the cutting tool. Okay, we are not defining the features of the cutting tool with respect to any machine. We are representing the different angles with respect to its own edges or faces, or surfaces. So that is tool reference system. A work reference system is based on the workpiece. Okay, how the workpiece is oriented against the cutting tool. Based on that, you will define the tool geometry. Okay, we are not going to look into the details of this. Just you have to understand that there are various kinds of systems for representing the cutting tool. And tool in hand system we have already seen. So we should discuss this ASA system and tool reference systems, ORS and NRS. So we'll discuss these three mainly, ASA, ORS, and just we'll look at how this NRS system looks like. Okay. Shall we look at this ASA system? Okay, let us see. We have some time. Now, this is the cutting tool, single point turning tool. And this is the workpiece. This is workpiece. This is tool. Now, you see, this is the direction of depth of cut. This is the direction of feed. And you can see X prime or X dash is representing the machine longitudinal axis. Okay. So this plane is called machine longitudinal plane and represented by pi X. Plane containing this X prime is pi X. Okay. So this plane pi X is passing through the cutting point and it contains x dash in it. Okay. So that is one thing. And it is perpendicular to this black plane here is pi r reference plane, which is perpendicular to the cutting velocity direction. Okay. So this is pi r, which is simply horizontal, and at the cutting location. Okay, if you take one plane which contains this x prime, that is pi x. Similarly, if you take one vertical plane which is perpendicular to pi r, vertical means, and it is also perpendicular to this pi x. So this plane with these dots is pi y. So there are now three mutually perpendicular planes. So those planes are defined based on the geometry of the machine tool or the axis of the machine tool. X direction of the machine tool, along the longitudinal axis of the machine tool, you have defined pi y, and pi r is anyhow okay, is horizontal, which is perpendicular to the cutting velocity vector VC. Okay, so these planes okay are used to define different angles of the cutting tool. Now let us see the cutting tool in different views. Same thing, whatever I have explained here is represented. This is pi x, this is pi y, pi r. Okay, so xm is machine longitudinal axis, ym is machine transverse axis. So machine vertical axis is zm. Okay, and if you see from the top, this is top view, you can see these planes as lines. Pi x is here. If you see from the top, you will see that as a line, and similarly pi y will also be looking like a line, and pi r, this entire plane is pi r. The view on, okay, the plane on which you have drawn this figure is pi r. Okay, let us stop here because I think we will not be able to complete this okay today, so better we stop it here and discuss this ASA system in detail in the next class. So just a second, I am taking the attendance. And if you have any doubts or any clarification required, then you can ask. And your evaluation process, as far as evaluation process is concerned, it will be like normal procedure. You will have two minors and one mid, then one end exam. So minors will I'll tell how the pattern of the minors will be. So it may be 15 marks, get two minors, each minor for 15 marks, one mid for 30 marks, and one end exam. Otherwise okay, we'll have minors, two minors each. Okay, each minor will be for 10 marks, and one component may be 10 marks may be kept for the assignments. So that we'll finalize and let you know. Okay, that's all for today. If you have any doubts, so then we can discuss. Otherwise, we can complete this class. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Have a good day.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.